Hello, everybody. Welcome to the East West Shrine Bowl preview, players to watch video. I don't really know what this is, but I went through the roster, looked at the East offense and defense, the West offense and defense, wrote down a few guys that we would like to keep an eye on during the process of the East West Shrine Bowl, kind of going over not everything you need to know, but just kind of a brief profile on these guys and what to watch and whatnot. Now, this is a smaller bowl game than like the Senior Bowl, so there's not as major, you know, hitters here. There are guys you probably won't even know, but you need to know. These guys will all that I'm pointing out here could be top five round picks, maybe even, you know, even a lot higher. I'm scrolling through right now, and there's some names in here that you will definitely know if you're following the draft process. And there might be a guy or two you don't really recognize the name, but it's good to pick up on what, you know, what it is, who it is, and what they do, and what, you know, position, draft, just stuff like that. Starting with the East offense, we're going to go Devin Leary up first, the quarterback out of Kentucky. He's playing for the East side, the quarterback or one of the quarterbacks over there. He's well known in NFL circles, or reportedly well known in NFL circles. Great career with NC State, moves over to Kentucky. Through the last half of the season, he really started to catch a stride, did have quite a few turnovers, and maybe not the bestest of seasons. I like what I see with the draft profile, Devin Leary. I think he profiles really well. And then you go watch the tape, and there are things that you watch and you question, but there's definitely things that you watch and you really like. And I think Devin Leary's one to watch as like a top five round quarterback with, you know, some things to like, and might be a solid backup. I don't know. He's an NFL quarterback regardless, and I'd like to see where he ends up draft-wise, because I don't really know where to project him. We'll hit on an East wide receiver, Cornelius Johnson out of Michigan. Not the fastest man alive, but standing at 6'3", Cornelius still has enough athleticism to take the top off a defense and add to this deeper wide receiving group. There's some receiver names in here, especially on the West, that we're going to get to that are just absolutely like, I don't understand how they're not in the Senior Bowl, something like that. It's not like these players are significantly worse and how they get downgraded to this bowl. I just don't know how I haven't like really dug or heard a lot about some of these guys, and I'm happy to bring some light to some of these guys. But yeah, Cornelius Johnson, 6'3", great size, obviously went to Michigan. He's a good player, solid production, not over crazy or anything amazing. And even at 6'3", he has his athleticism traits to carry him over the top of a defense, makes him a little bit more dynamic than like a 6'3" contested catch type of guy. Illinois' Isaiah Williams, playing at wide receiver for the East side as well. Williams is a fast, explosive receiver, and NFL guys like Isaiah and other wide receiver will hit on in a minute. The NFL people really want like Isaiah, and then we'll hit on a guy later that NFL guys were asking for to be at the East-West Shrine Bowl. They like to see what he does in certain situations, if their offense caps them at a certain, you know, whatever. You're looking for the talent a little further down, you know, third through fifth round. I don't think any of these guys are bona fide second round picks, if I'm looking at it, or anything like that in this receiving group. So Isaiah Williams, a fun one to watch, a little bit smaller than Cornelius, obviously, at 6'3", it's tough to beat, but Isaiah is a fun one. Can't wait to see how he does in some of the drills. Dallin Holker, the East tight end from Colorado State, one of the East-West Shrine's top guys. This guy, halfway through the season, I think he really broke out. I think it was against Colorado. Really broke out and started to have his success. He was a vertical threat, a good pass catcher, someone that can just consistently thread the needle or cut the seam or work outside, come back to the ball, catch the ball, reliable. Dallin Holker offers a lot when it comes to like what we've seen from this tight end class. Sure, it's very top heavy in Brock Bowers, and then you have to fall quite a ways down to find guys like JT, Cade Stover, and then Ben Sinnott is there. But you're looking at a guy like Dallin who could be a, you know, I think the fourth round feels like good for him, and he could be a contributor right away, maybe a tight end too to start off with while he starts to learn and adjust in the NFL world. McCallum Castle, someone that you probably flies under the radar, 24 years old already, but moves really well. Smooth guy, and I hope he shows up as a smooth guy. I hope he really goes into the East-West Shrine Bowl, shows what he's got. Solid draft profile, seems to profile like overall as an NFL tight end. Now, probably not a number one, but definitely a contributor, someone that can get you up to 200 yards a season, doing some of the dirty work, and maybe be a motion man, something like that. McCallum Castles has a role, and like, if all goes well with him, if he's as good moving, he's got the experience at the college level, I think he actually could contribute pretty early on in his career while still learning some of the stuff to help improve his game and only get better through his NFL career. Walter Rouse will be playing offensive tackle. Now, I don't know if he's left or right side, and I don't know if he could adjust. I think he might be a left tackle. I'm totally guessing there based off one of the images I think I remember looking at. So he's a Stanford transfer. He gets to play for one of the best offensive line coaches in the country, reportedly one of the best. I don't know this. I'm not a big college football guy. But really getting into the draft process this year, you're starting to learn a little bit about different coaching staffs, what offenses, you know, stuff like that. And apparently, Oklahoma has one of the better offensive line coaches in the country. I didn't write down his name, and I can't remember it, so I do apologize to that guy. Sorry if you're watching, bud. Didn't get your name in here. I'm sure it matters a lot. I need to talk about the two guys, two hands. So on one of the last plays where Oklahoma is trying to beat, I believe it is Texas, where he has two rushers coming. I think one of the interior offensive linemen missed, or just the quarterback didn't point it out. Whatever. He goes like this. He has two arms out, and he's blocking two guys at the same time. Now, maybe he's holding, and I think I'll show you guys a video. But I don't know if you want to call it holding or not, because it's such a heroic play. And then they get the last touchdown there, the last laugh against Texas for the win, I think. And yeah, Walter Rouse really made the play there, and I don't think you know, maybe the general perception doesn't get a good hold of what the hell Walter Rouse just did. But yeah, I mean, it happened, and it's a super fun highlight to watch. Now, Boston College's Christian Mahogany play guard for the East Side, probably the first interior offensive line drafted out of the Shrine Bowl group. He was the first team freshman All-American, maybe first or second, I don't know. And then I think was like a first or second team All-American. And while he was a freshman and got the freshman team, I think they got hurt. Long recovery. He took it serious and he had a great recovery. Same old, we're looking at Christian Mahogany as probably one of the better interior offensive line and probably the best in the Shrine Bowl. Someone you, I don't know. I don't know if he's one to like keep tabs on or whatever, but if you just see him go to your team or something when the draft actually comes around and it's pretty high, I don't think it's like a extremely wasted pick. I think he plays with a chip on his shoulder. I think he is serious enough. He's a football guy and he plays at a high level. So Christian Mahogany, not a bad player, and definitely one that can dominate and really show up at a place like Shrine Bowl where he might have some lower level competition. And that is a guy that lower level competition will have a good baseline. Like you see, I'll talk about, you know, defensive linemen coming up here in just a second, but I'll take Muhammad Kamara out of Colorado State. A little undersized guy, but hey, if he does well against Christian Mahogany, or if Leonard Taylor, Evan Anderson, or one of the defensive linemen on the west side, you know, if they do well against Mahogany, it shows really well for the guy that's going against Mahogany. And you know, people won't necessarily knock Christian Mahogany as much as they'll look at it like, oh, he just beat Christian Mahogany, like that sort of deal. Just talked about him. Defensive lineman out of Florida Atlantic, Evan Anderson, a big body that's incredibly hard to move. I think he's listed 6'3", 356, one of the bigger guys in this class. And yeah, he was described as a total stump and pillar, and I'm guessing against the run. I'm pretty sure he might do a good job there. True nose tackle, come, you know, third, fourth round, bottom of the fourth is probably where I'd have a guy like this, but teams are willing to take shots, especially with true nose tackles with yeah, I guess just good movement or whatever. Evan Anderson is one to watch for late third round, maybe. That could potentially come in and be like a defensive tackle too, or a nose tackle, like a true nose for a team that really wants one. So Evan Anderson, Florida Atlantic, powerhouse at 356, big ass body that's incredibly hard to move. Now there's Leonard Taylor out of Miami, but he is going to be there, still working through an injury, might not take the field, but might also be someone to watch for as the week and practices go on, as he's got some stunts where he looks both very powerful, very quick. Knowing that he is that talented, he might go out there and show these players, the coaching, the NFL guys that are there, what's up? I'm here to prove myself, if you will. And I mean, he's already a top like two round guy. Like, I think he's a second round guy. I don't think he'll sneak into the first now that we've seen like Byron Murphy and Jerzon Newton and the results of this season. But Leonard Taylor, even a possible earlier to mid second rounder, could still come out and say, hey, I am better than these guys. I'm going to show NFL talent or NFL scouts, evaluators, and everything like that, that I can do this. And I'm still even working through an injury, so take it at that. I think Leonard Taylor might go out and play, but I think he might just be smart and keep it down low as he's working through that injury. Colorado State's Mohamed Kamara, he's for the East Side on the edge for them. Guy I took earlier as an example, he's a bit undersized, but he has good quickness and urgency to his game. Seems like a super fun player. I'd watch for a rise as he works through the draft process. If he goes to the combine, tests well, I think he will test well. And if he does, I think that this guy could be a riser. And I don't know where he'd be currently placed. Someone of his size doesn't typically, I mean, he did have great production, but it is kind of taken with a grain of salt because I think they had also one of the more productive guys on the other side. It's confusing. Mohamed has a lot of factors playing into his draft stock, but when all comes down to it, I can see him going in the top four rounds, impact player, rotational edge rusher in just his second year in the league, situational pass rusher as well, as he is a little undersized, maybe not fit as much against the run. So we'll see how the rest of this process goes for Mohamed Kamara, or Mo Kamara, as he I guess has written down or might prefer. So apologize if I'm using Mohamed a little too much for Mo, but I don't know. I like him. I liked ever since I saw or came across what he looked like on paper. Saw him a little bit, and I like what potentially he offers or what he potentially offers and what his potential obviously brings. He's got a pretty high ceiling. Now the Shrine Bowl snagged a stud here with Edgerrin Cooper out of Texas A&M, probably the best linebacker in this class. Big riser this year, and he started to put all of his tools together and make big plays all over that Texas A&M defense. Just continued to be a consistent playmaker, stood out on tape. Edgerrin Cooper, top two round. I don't know if he fits into that first. Some believe he will. I don't think so, just because like there's such scarcity at interior or inside linebacker or linebacker in general in this class that you might consider taking one at the late end of the first. I don't think that's the deal. I don't think that's where we see Cooper or the first linebacker fall off, as I think he is linebacker one, but some may believe otherwise. Now, guys, sing and dance over Jerrion Jones, who actually plays the nickel for Florida State and was actually described as like someone that could even get some safety reps at the East-West Shrine. I don't think we're going to see him get safety. I don't really think he's there. I think he's more of a bona fide nickelback with true size, stocky, physical, that makes good plays with his head. He's incredibly smart, has some great statistics, and really showed up this year with all the numbers on paper, what he looked like on tape. He just looked like a very solid player, and hell, this guy can go pretty high with all the traits I'm hearing about, but only 1 year of this sort of production maybe brings that down. Him being a nickelback is positional value that brings him down, whatever it may be. And if you guys don't know what nickelback, that's slot corner. So when you see like NB, or I normally have it written down as cornerback / nickelback, because he plays corner, but it's slot corner, which is also described as a nickel. So Jerrion Jones plays slot cornerback, which is like a Brian Branch type of role, if you guys were interested last year in the draft. And that's pretty much it for the East Side. We'll move to the West offense. Quarterback Talia Tagovailoa, don't really know like the 100% correct one. I couldn't even be Talia. It could be like Taliua. Is that racist? I don't know. Maryland quarterback, best known for his relation to Tua Tagovailoa or Tagovailoa, and his longer college career. He looked for some more eligibility this year, entered the transfer portal, got denied his eligibility for the over this offseason or whatever. And now he's in the East-West Shrine Bowl. He's severely undersized and not nearly the playmaker Bryce Young was. So he's really going to have a tough time come draft time, maybe the last two rounds, sixth, seventh round. I don't know. I personally don't fall in the Talia train or the Tagovailoa. I don't think that there's really plenty here, but he's also a guy with a lot to prove and someone who's been a consistent starter. He's put up good numbers. He's had some great games at Maryland, and that's why he's one to watch, is he can vary so much between one opinion and the other that who knows, maybe he comes out with just multiple things to just rave and love about as he comes out of the East-West Shrine, getting through this draft process. Maybe his name only builds, and boom, just like that, he's a fourth or fifth round project quarterback that could be a solid backup in the league, and you're always shooting for the Brock Purdy type now, and who knows. Southern Miss's Frank Gore Jr., and yes, Frank Gore Sr.'s son. So, you know, Frank Gore, long time running back in the NFL, mostly known for his time with the 49ers. He's apparently, or allegedly, the top one or two best pass-blocking running backs in this class. And that is a quote from Eric Galco, the director of, like, sports personnel, or not sports, director of, like, player personnel and stuff like that for the East-West Shrine Bowl. He runs a lot of it and does a great job with it. But he says in this whole class, Frank Gore could be, like, the best or second best pass-blocking running backs, which is crazy. And he's a different type of player than his dad, but the mentality seems the same. Kind of has that drive. Frank Gore should be an interesting one. I love the way he wears his shoulder pads. He might just have a small neck too that makes him look big, but he wears them pretty stout and high. Frank Gore is one to watch out for. He's put up some solid productivity in the college ranks now, given it is at Southern Miss. The Yankee twins, I don't know. It's Jackson and Jordan Janky or Yankee. I don't know how to pronounce it. I'm gonna say Yankee because I think that's what I heard. So I do apologize if I'm absolutely butchering the crap out of these names. From what I read, these twins seem really cool, loyal, and incredibly talented. It's a fun story. Coach joked about them playing linebackers, so you get the type of body type they are. Super fun and energetic bunch, it seems. They went back, and I think this is FBS football is what South Dakota State plays in, the FBS stuff. I think they won back-to-back titles over there. They're a big part of that. I think it was Jaden that was a little bit more productive than Jackson. And, you know, Jaden may look a little bit more of the hard worker type than Jackson with the flashy sunglasses, the girlfriend, all that aside. These are a hardworking duo here. This is a hardworking duo. Identical twins with great size, both at 6'3", 210 is both what they're listed at. I'm guessing they come in like officially different. Maybe both at 6'2", one at 6'2", one at 6'3", maybe. And then different weight, obviously. I don't think it's that might be crazy if they both come in and officially weigh both in at the same weight around 210. That'd be nuts. Jalen Coker, someone that flies so far under the radar, but could actually end up being a top 100 player for some of these NFL guys and some of the scouts. Played at a small school like Holy Cross, always had extra defensive attention, but still got open. He was productive, and he's a great athlete. They've seen GPS numbers on him, and they say he's going to test great, and you know, still has that separation despite the extra defensive attention because he's playing so well. They had one of the better head coaches in college football, or one of the uprising head coaches in college football. Small school again hinders what we like. How was he there for 4 years? Would like to see him transfer to a bigger school, whatever, with the transfer portal nowadays. But that's what I like about this kid. He stood his ground at Holy Cross, only got better, and he is getting a little bit of the attention now, and we'll see how he does and stands out as the East-West Shrine Bowl, as the offseason process, as the combine comes across. Jalen Coker might only be a name you see more frequently. Aj Washington out of USC, playing wide receiver for the West Side. University of Southern California, played along with Caleb Williams and really stood out on his tape. And you might watch it and you're like, okay, who's this? I think it was number 15. I don't know. I'm not going to guess. 16, something like that. I did guess. Okay, anyways, Aj Washington, always a big play threat no matter what. You might think he leads the country in yards if you just come across a USC game or something like that and he has a big catch. Like, he does it quite frequently, and Taj is always finding a way to find, you know, room after the catch, everything like that. Dynamic player, and worked with a guy like Caleb Williams. Now, he is a little bit on the smaller size. I think he's like 5'10", 175, what he was listed at from what I saw. And that, you know, take it in there, like you take some, you leave some, you know, talent, size, you know, stuff happens with players and everything like that, and their draft stock, things fluctuate. And if he comes in weighing around 180, 185, that'll only help him. But if he runs like a 4.49 to 4.55, that might suck a little bit. As I mean, I don't know. 4.4s is probably what I would shoot for if I'm Taj Washington while trying to add some extra weight on. But he says, if he says, hey, screw it, I'm still a small guy, I'm going to be a small guy, I'm going to play as a small guy, I'm going to try to go out there and run as fast as I can, I'm not going to worry about putting on extra weight to put down on paper for NFL scouts, that could be a little bit different. And I'm curious to see his approach to this offseason process and see how he does on some of these press coverage one-on-ones as a smaller guy. You need to have that package of releases, and I think he's playing at a big school like USC and facing some pretty good defenses and corners that I'm sure he can stand out at a place like East-West Shrine Bowl. Now, the most productive receiver in the East-West Shrine Bowl, Malik Washington out of Virginia, is going to be playing on the west side, and he's as productive as any receiver in the country. He's a bit small for NFL, but the NFL seems to like him and asked for him to be at the Shrine Bowl this year. So they had people call, like, I think there's some contacts in the NFL, like if certain executives or whatever want to see a certain player, like, hey, are you targeting this guy? If not, I'd like to see him at the Shrine Bowl. And then Eric Galco or whatever says, okay, we'll try our best to recruit him. We'll see what we see on tape, see if we agree with you and think he's worthy of the invite, whatever. And Malik Washington, I think over 1,400 yards, 110 catches officially on the year. He was as productive as any. He's a bit small. Again, 5'8", I believe he was listed at, but he's got a little bit more stockiness to him. I think he's around that 190 area. So Malik Washington will be such a fun player, and I'm going to be breaking him down at some point for sure. I have not gotten into his tape or deep into Malik Washington, but definitely one to watch out for. Mississippi State's speedster Lediatric Griffin, Eric Galco, the guy that I've continuously kind of brought up here because watched a little something with him, and that's kind of where I got a lot of these or this information or whatever. Anyways, he will challenge for the fastest time at the combine. That's Eric Galco's quote. He says he will challenge for the fastest time at the combine. I'll be floored if he doesn't run a 4.2 something. Nuts. That is insane. And if Lediatric Griffin really comes out and runs that fast, I'll be very happy and surprised to see someone like that. Again, a little bit smaller, looked a little thin, and might have to add to that, and that might take away from his 40 time, but hopefully not, and let's see him fly at the combine or something like that. Probably the biggest name here, Jatavion Sanders out of Texas. He's still rehabbing an injury, so he might not play at all, but if he looks out there, says, oh, I'm better than these guys. I think I could cook these guys that are out there right now in front of scouts, and we might go see him out there and participate just a tad. I don't know how realistic that is. I think he's a smart guy and just knocking interviews out of the way early at the East-West Shrine. So maybe someone to look out for if he hits the field at all. Other than that, just know he's there knocking some interviews out. Now, offensive tackle Matt Goncalves, I don't know, out of Pittsburgh, a big, long dude at 6'6", 330 pounds. Matt checks a lot of the boxes at tackle and could be solid depth on the NFL team, which is now very valuable. See how many injuries and stuff like that play into a team. You're looking for a guy like Matt, you know, to perhaps a fourth, fifth round pick. I don't know where his draft projection is about now. I think I read like a fourth round pick or something like that, maybe a fourth round grade on him, but offensive tackle to get a guy like solid, checks boxes, like I said, someone that could come in, maybe not play up to NFL starter level, but just below that, where you probably don't make the cut line to be like, oh, he's kind of replaceable or he's a low level starter. Like, you're always looking for a little bit better, but to come in as a backup or to develop into one of those solid starters type of guy. Matt Goncalves, I think he's played on both sides, if I'm not mistaken. Definitely could be wrong with that as well. But solid depth for an NFL team right away, and maybe could play himself into a starting role if he doesn't have to start there right away. Now, center Dylan McMahon. Now, this guy is like a nobody. No offense to Dylan. All right, sorry. NC State has a nasty center. He was described as the nastiest Probably offensive line or interior offensive line there, and that's always fun to watch. So I just can't wait to see some reps from Dylan McMahon as he will line up in some of these practices and everything like that. We saw it was Trevor Penning a couple years back. I think it was in the Senior Bowl where he was literally just bitching dudes. And Dylan McMahon, I love the nasty type. I like the ones to watch that are always just like get up in your pads and getting pretty rough. It's a fun to watch thing. Like, I watched Cade Stover tape, and he absolutely demolishes a Notre Dame defender just like kind of coming off the edge or whatever. He's hitting a chip block to get him out of the way and just put him on the ground. And that, to me, is very fun to watch. Nathan Pickering, the defensive lineman out of Mississippi State, talked about as a crazy athlete like Kobe Turner was last year. Maybe not to that same caliber, but trains with the same people as Kobe did and is likely to come out and test super well. Now, if he does, that's a little like keep. I didn't really know him before this, and I don't know how much that'll really raise him if he's already expected to come out and be this good and he's training with the right people. So Kobe Turner last year came in, Wake Forest guy, I believe, put up freak numbers. East West Shrine Bowl had some crazy highlights on tape and practice and stuff like that, and went to the combines, I think, like crazy fast as a like 290 pound defensive tackle. And we're seeing the same traits and upside here with Nathan Pickering. Maybe not the technical aspect. I don't think he's as good as Kobe with his hands, pass rush, whatever. But athletically, Nathan Pickering with enough training and with the right people might test super well, but maybe not up to that Kobe Turner standard. But there's always a chance, and that's a reason to keep your eye out for Nathan Pickering. Now, a player I love after just hearing a little bit about him, not watching a single dose of tape, Sundiata Anderson out of Grambling State. This kid is probably the best edge rusher at the Shrine Bowl. He's like the lead guy. He is the guy, all right? He's a good player all around. He's missing a few things, obviously, but if you're here and you're looking at players, I think he will impress a lot off the edge. He's a possible third or fourth round pick, does a lot really well, and has great athleticism, and he's got good size to pair with that athleticism and great movement for that size that makes him so like athletic or appear to be so bendy or I don't really know. But Sundiata Anderson, definitely one to keep your eye on, and could definitely be a riser and find his way into the mid-third round range is probably where I'd see a ceiling. Or I would actually set the ceiling like late second, early third, maybe. But yeah, Sundiata Anderson, someone to watch for sure out of Grambling State. Absolute dog. We get to talk about a productive edge rusher in Gabriel Murphy on the other side of Leatu at UCLA. He was on the other side, obviously, of one of the better pass rushers in this class, if not the best pure pass rusher. And Leatu, such a technician with his hands, maybe he learned a little bit of that. Gabriel Murphy maybe learned a little bit of what Leatu was doing. But yeah, productive edge rusher, had some big size and maybe a higher floor than others at the East-West Shrine Bowl. So Gabriel Murphy, one to keep tabs on, might be a consistent performer in the practices, maybe in the game as well. And just one to really watch draft stock-wise, because I could see, you know, if the right people see the right things about Gabriel Murphy, they might think about taking him at a certain, you know, time in the draft or whatever. He might have a higher grade for some teams than others. Complicated, but I'm saying Gabriel Murphy, depending on how you like higher floor players, he might be one to watch for you. Butcher the hell out of this, but it's Zion Tupola or Tupuola. Tupuola Fatui. I'm just going to say that. I had a name that I actually took out of here, another Washington interior guy. It was Toli Letoli Lesanoa or something. That is probably so far off, but yeah, this is a tough one here. Out of Washington, he was invited to the Shrine Bowl last year when he was probably not as highly like looked at, or he wasn't looked at as highly as he is now. Got banged up, so luckily he had his opportunity to go back to school. It's not like he had to come out as a senior with no more eligibility and everything like that. So Zion was invited last year, got banged up, went back to school. As it came out to be a good choice, he raised his draft stock, and he got a little bit better as a player, and then he's getting his shot to prove himself with, and a chance to draft or raise his draft stock even higher through this process. And you can tell it's getting a little long. We're more than a half hour into recording this, so a lot of talking for me, and you start to fumble a little bit. Luckily, we're on like the last three players right now, and the last player, by the way, so fun and such a interesting topic. Can't wait to get to that one. But before then, we'll talk about someone else. Beal Chambers came out and was thought of a liability starting this year. Came out and actually showed mass improvement in his coverage. Just improved and improved over the last year. Made some big strides overall. And he stands out on the tape here and there. He makes some plays here and there. He made his strides this year. And I think he's really... you know, he kind of proved he's coachable. He's kind of proving that he is worth kind of the pick. And just a player I really like the profile of. Someone to watch out for sure, Steel Chambers. And then we'll move to another linebacker, kind of on the opposite side of the spectrum. Freak athlete at Curtis Jacobs, and no surprise here, Penn State guy. And he will probably be the biggest tester outside of potentially Edgerrin Cooper, who you saw earlier on the East team. But he's a freak, and he has some good upside. Might be more of a project for the NFL. You know, the NFL might see him as someone that, you know, do we want to take him as high because we believe in the player he could be, or do we want to take him lower because he's going to have to be sculpted as someone that is going to be like a utility, certain, maybe a 4-3 outside linebacker at times. It'll be interesting. I don't know where certain teams have him graded. I don't know the draft projection. But man, oh me, if he comes out and puts his numbers in and runs like a 4-3 as a linebacker, that'll have people raving and the general media hype might take over. We've seen it with like Trayvon Walker before, where he starts to get some praise in the late draft process. And then we see some guys later in the draft, like a guy like Curtis Jacobs, has the ability to go out there, test like a freak, and then people go and look at the plus side of him on film and be like, oh, I really like this. Oh, I really like that. He doesn't do that so well, but hey, maybe we can fix that. And that's where it gets really intriguing with a guy like Curtis Jacobs coming out of Penn State as an absolute freak. Talk about unorthodox is about as weird as it gets for me. Cornerback Quantez Stiggers out of the Toronto Argonauts, CFL guys, current CFL player. He won CFL Rookie of the Year. He is 22. He didn't go to college, so rules prevent him from working out for NFL teams, going through certain processes, whatever. He bounced around the Fan Control Football League. I think he put up some crazy numbers in a few amount of games, got signed to the Toronto Argonauts in the CFL, and now has a window to work out and show what he's got, which is absolutely crazy. Stiggers, crazy production in just 1 year in the CFL, has his window now to show he is a capable guy, and I am so like intrigued by this. This is very fun for me to like get hype for, or very easy to get hype for, as this will be someone super fun to keep an eye out on in the drills, in the game, as a player, as a whole. It'll be super fun, as Quantez will be definitely on my radar, and he should be on yours as well. Anyways, that'll be all for me. Thank you guys for watching. If you guys enjoyed, give him a like, go down, subscribe, go watch the past content on the channel. A lot of mock drafts out recently. Been figuring stuff out, and I think I'm finally getting to the point where we're working like daily draft content now, and we'll start to really work that in starting next week. So a sub would be great. You come back to watch. I'll be talking about the Senior Bowl coming up here soon as well, keeping tabs on the East-West Shrine Bowl and some of these players. And yeah, that'll be all for me. Thank you guys for watching. Killed my other monitor. That'll be all for me. Thank you guys for watching. If you guys enjoyed, give me a like. Wait, I already said that. See you guys next time. Deuces.